Adolescent, who's 3 to 5. School age, who's 250 to 350. A toddler, and then who's 150 to 250? An infant. Very good. Okay. Sugar, honey, jams, jellies, fruit spreads, and molasses, syrups, candy, regular chewing gum, regular gelatin, pudding, custard, sugar, water, or water ice with sugar, better known to some of us as a popsicle, ice cream, frozen yogurt, frosted cakes, cookies, pastry pies, sweets, rolls, sweet breads, donuts, beverages such as tonic, which contains sugar, or corn syrup, frappes, which McDonald's has, of course, and others, milkshakes, chocolate or flavored milk, eggnog, fruited or flavored yogurt, condensed milk, fruit, canned and served, fruit drinks, fruit nectars. What are these? A little bit more than that. Things you should avoid on, which, okay, with no concentrated sweet. So once again, that's your list of foods to avoid when on a no concentrated sweet. And we said that clients often have trouble with this because they'll tell you it doesn't taste sweet. Or they'll say, I didn't use sugar, I used something else to sweeten it, but yet it's something that's on this list. So we didn't need to do a lot of education. Okay, notes. Can use the mouth, the vagina, the rectum. For removal of the gallbladder, the vagina is used most often, and the main advantage of this procedure are the lack of visible incisions and minimal, if any, postoperative complications. What'd you find out? Pardon me? Well, no, it's more than laparoscopic. It is not laparoscopic. The notes actually stands for something.
No, it's orifice something.
They're going to use the mouth, the rectum, the vagina. They're using a body orifice. So remember, that is the natural orifice transluminal endoscopic surgery. So remember, if they were going to do laparoscopic, they would go through the abdomen. But they don't have to do that. That would leave you with incisions. So you can use notes to do this. And remember, it's not available every place, but for people who do it, they love it. Because, I mean, there's no incisions, you know, not, at least that are not visible with that. Okay, water. 8 to 12 hours only before the test. NPO for the first 2 hours of the test. Resume a normal diet 4 hours after swallowing the capsule. Uses a belt with sensors attached to the client and swallows with a glass of water. Return to normal activity for the remainder of the study. The test takes about 8 hours and this is excreted in the stool. What'd your client have? Which one? Not barium.
It's
little capsules. Very good. That is a small bowel capsule endoscopy. Okay, very good. So sometimes there'll be a word in there that'll help you. Excessive relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter, delayed gastric emptying, smoking and other tobacco products, eating large meals, obesity, caffeinated beverages, chocolate, citrus fruits, tomatoes, and tomato products. What's this going to predispose your client to?
Heartburn.
GERD, that is absolutely right. These are factors associated with the development of esophageal reflux disease. Okay, a flat lesion of less than 1 centimeter. It's a macule. Very good. Remember, you've got that whole list on page 438 that has all the different lesions with that one. But very good, that was a macule. Excellent. Displace skin away from the injection site by 1 to 1.5 inches. Keep the skin displaced during the injection and wait for 10 seconds after injecting medication, then withdraw the needle and let the skin return to normal position.
Z-track.
Very good. That is the Z-track method from way back there in the first week. Scrotal support, ice bags to the scrotum, elevation of scrotum with a soft pillow, avoid coughing, encourage deep breathing and ambulation, monitor voiding, no lifting of anything heavier than 10 pounds. And 10 pounds is pretty average, but I did kind of put in there or is guided by the primary practitioner. But don't not choose it because they say 10 pounds, because 10 pounds is standard. Okay, so I mean, that's real common. So what is this client having? At what time of hernia? Very good. Those are general postoperative care with an inguinal hernia repair. Excellent. H. pylori, immunosuppressive disorders, emotional stress and acute anxiety, corticosteroids, radiation therapy, caffeine, coffee, alcohol, ingestion of corrosive substances, acids and alkalis, NSAIDs, which are long-term, and then others. What are these risk factors for?
Ulcers.
Stress.
Possibly. Not the one that I'm thinking about, but that's an okay answer. What else? If it's not an ulcer, what else is it predisposing them to?
Gastritis.
What type?
Stress.
Mm. these are risk factors for acute gastritis with that. Okay, so if these are risk factors for acute gastritis, what are risk factors for chronic gastritis? Does H. pylori show up again? Yeah, it absolutely can with that. Chronic local irritation, the alcohol, radiation therapy, smoking can show up. Surgical procedures that did the pyloric sphincter, some systemic disorders, toxic substances. Autoimmune can show up. Genetics. Okay. An anemia where nervous system function remains normal. This type does not affect nerve function. And common causes are dietary deficiency, malabsorption syndromes, and drugs. Which deficiency? Not iron. B12? Folic acid. Very good. Folic acid. The key here is that the nervous system function remains normal with this one. Okay, anything else to say about that? Common causes just for that one, poor nutrition, lack of leafy green vegetables, liver, yeast, citrus fruits, dried beans, nuts, fortified, refined grain products. That is your primary way now for folic acid that people don't have to think about it. Remember the government said, oh, neural tube defects. You know, it's going to affect unborn babies, so remember they added it to refine, you know, grain products with that. But still, those leafy green vegetables, you can't forget about them. They are wonderful. They need to be a part of our diet for multiple reasons. Loss of articulation at the bone ends in the joint capsule following severe trauma. Oh, if I have that, does that mean I'm going to be able to move? Oh, I'm not going to be able to move. Not whatever this is. Most common sites are the shoulder, the hip, the knee, the finger, subluxation, partial dislocation. And the pathophysiology may be congenital, traumatic, or pathologic. Where does the spine have? What's the key word up there? What do they keep talking about?
Dislocation.
Ah, very good. They're talking about the pulled up joint. Loss of articulation is a joint dislocation with that. And remember, unfortunately for our athletes, it's often when they slide into home base for the baseball, or my daughter going after basketball, which I sometimes swear looks like wrestling, and you know, track when they're going over hurdles and they go wherever the hurdle sends them, and they shouldn't be with that. And remember with this, they usually can't move the joint at all until we put it back. Our results from metabolic imbalances of cholesterol and bile salts, and it's the most common type found in adults, and we talked about that just a little earlier. What type of stone? Yeah, but what type? Cholesterol. That is a cholesterol gallstone. Remember, the other type is a pigment stone with that. Begins as a papule that turns into a vesicle at the entry site. The vesicle ruptures and forms an erosion, and serous fluid forms the characteristic honey-colored crust. Imtago with that. And then once they start antibiotic ointment, how long are they infectious for? How many hours? It is 24. Infection, they're communicable for 24 hours after they start the treatment. Okay, Bryce, what does the R stand for?
Rest.
I. C. And E.
Elevation.
Absolutely with this. Remember, one of the best things that we can do when we have someone who has a soft tissue injury is find out when the pain is worse, because when do we want to give pain medication to them? Before they do whatever the pain is worse for. So if they have to ambulate, then we want to make sure we give it to them then. If they have to go to physical therapy, I don't want to give it at 8 o'clock in the morning if their physical therapy is at 10, right? So one of the best things we can do is when they have these PRN pain medications is make sure we assess to see what aggravates the condition, assess what makes it worse, and then we can plan our pain intervention around that. Plain film of the abdomen, acute abdomen series. What's that called? It's just a general name. What is it? It's an x-ray. In medicine, we call it a radiographic exam. If they're just having a plain, old, ordinary x-ray, do they have a prep?
No.
No? Do they have to be MPO?
No.
No? I mean, literally, if it's just a plain film, I mean, there's no, you know, when you hear things like radiation precautions, that's usually when they put something in somebody. And then they have radiation precautions like when they go to the bathroom and stuff like that. So we have nothing like that. I mean, they have the test and it's over with. So the main thing we have to do is educate them that they're having an x-ray. That's about all our function is with this. Sometimes when we're working with people too, there are other things that we educate people about. When when you have a client who has like liver failure, what's gonna be the primary risk factor that we're going to talk to them about? My liver does a lot of my what factors? Helps with clotting, right? So if I have someone who has liver disease or liver failure, then my primary worry is going to be bleeding with them. And so, I mean, there's lots of times that we educate people about different conditions. An intravenous pyelogram is an example, an IVP. It goes against the normal flow of urine. In this case, the ureters and pelvis of both kidneys are studied. It uses a dye, and we assess her allergies. What type of procedure? And the key word here is to go against the flow. It's what type of procedure?
Pyelogram?
Well, it isn't. That is a pyelogram.
Oh.
But this pyelogram goes against the flow. Pardon me? Well, that's real close. How about a retrograde procedure? Right, we're going against the issue with this. Now, when I see the word intravenous pyelogram, when I see dye or I know that about tests, what's a priority assessment before the procedure?
Allergies.
Allergies, seafood, iodine, shrimp, chocolate. There'll be a list depending on what dye they have with that. Computed tomography uses a lot of dyes as well. So that would be another place where I would think about my allergies with those. Obstruction, stones, diabetes, gender, age, postmenopausal, and since they added that, that's gonna be key. Sexual activity and recent use of antibiotics. What are these things contributing to?
Menopause.
More common as I age. May have never had any until they got to the point when they're UTI, very good. These are factors contributing to urinary tract infections with these. Remember, the postmenopausal was key because of the low estrogen really predisposes them to make them susceptible to infections with that. Remember, your client may also be very embarrassed to talk about this issue. Often if we don't bring it up, they won't bring it up. So we have to bring it up because they often don't always talk the same way we talk about things. We may talk about urine, they may talk about pee. We gotta make sure that we tell them whatever language they need to utilize to get their point across to us is perfectly acceptable. Make it as comforting for them as what we possibly can. Megaloblastic or macrocytic, the symptoms include pallor, jaundice, glossitis, that smooth beaky red tongue should help us key in on what this answer is, fatigue, paresthesias, weight loss, confusion, difficulty maintaining their balance, they lose their position sense, which is a proprioception with that. What do they have? What type of anemia?
B12.
Very good. This one's vitamin B12 deficiency with this. And once again, with this one, we talk about the fact they need to include, if it's acceptable to them, animal proteins and eggs. They can also utilize things like nuts and dairy products, dried beans, citrus fruits, and guess what comes up again? Green leafy vegetables with that. So we really can't go wrong with those. So remember for this, although animal protein's the easiest way to incorporate them, you know, into your diet, the vegetarian can easily do this too. And then if they just can't take enough in, can we supplement this?
Mm-hmm.
Sure we can. Absolutely. Okay, eat a well-balanced diet that includes 5 servings of whole grains, fresh fruits, and vegetables. Drink 8 to 10 glasses of fluid per day. Engage in daily exercise to stimulate peristalsis. Set aside uninterrupted time after breakfast or dinner for using the toilet. Do not ignore the urge to defecate. And whenever there is a significant or prolonged change in bowel habit, report this to your healthcare provider. What are these methods to do? Well, we're gonna even more simple than bowel training. Anybody can do these. They help you maintain what?
Normal bowel
function. How about bowel function? I'll take that. Methods to maintain just normal bowel function. These are things that anybody can do. But everything you said, they could also assist with that. But these are just normal methods that everybody can utilize to help maintain a normal function. So if I maintain my normal function, what might I not get? I might not get constipated. That's right. Proper bathing and skin moisturizing, therapeutic baths with colloidal oatmeal, fingernails trimmed short with rough edges filed and clean, wearing mittens or splints at night, cool sleeping environment, cool shower, herbal tea, sedating antihistamines at bedtime, avoid tight clothing. I could use tar extracts, and there's antihistamines came up again. It's no more important than what it was previously. I just got it on there twice. What are these interventions for? Not quite urticaria, but
chickenpox.
It is something.
Poison ivy.
Okay, how about interventions for pruritus? So it's real close, because I can have pruritus with urticaria, but I can have pruritus by itself too. These are just interventions for pruritus with that. Okay, inadequate iron intake caused by iron deficient diet, chronic alcoholism, malabsorption syndrome. So remember, that could be things like Crohn's and others. What type of anemia is this one? This one's iron deficiency anemia. And this one, once again, eating the meat-free diet is correlated with this. Once again, it doesn't have to occur. Our vegetarians just need to be very good about complementing their proteins. Surgery to relieve obstruction, medications, bladder compression, and intermittent self-catheterization. What type of incontinence are they working with? Interventions for which one? And the key here is bladder compression. It won't empty till you help them.
Neurogenic?
Not quite that, but they could be used for some of those. If it won't empty, it will get what? Okay, so how about interventions for overflow? In other words, it won't flow out, so it'll just keep filling, and so we'll get overflow incontinence, or they call it reflex incontinence with this. Valsalva, Cruday, those are things that they're talking about with the bladder compression, and you probably would have picked it up if we would have said Valsalva or Cruday instead of just bladder compression, but those are the types with that. And there are others listed. Okay, the preferred injection site for infants and children prior to walking. That is the vastus lateralis. It will come up next year as well in OB. Start with a pathogen, and that means I had to have portal entry. Tissue inflammation, then down to edema, down to decreased blood flow to the bone, bone necrosis, bone abscess. What is this client getting? Osteomyelitis with that. When they have this, you really, particularly, you don't wait till they get it. If they've had a puncture wound, maybe they were, I don't know, building a house and a 2x4 or a little splinter went through. Whenever you have this, we go ahead and we start a care plan or we start a concept map that says that they're at risk for this. So, you know, we know when you've had that type of injury, they're going to be at risk for it. A real common example, one of the ladies that was zip lining a few years ago fell into water, had a fracture that caused a portal of entry, and she ended up with this really, really bad. So it certainly can happen. Less than 11, there's a severe risk. 12 to 14 is a moderate risk. 15 to 16 is a mild risk. And if it's greater than 16, we just continue the routine assessment. What did the nurse do? What type of scale?
Braden.
Okay. Braden score, Braden scale. It's the exact same thing. Absolutely. That is the Braden. Insert 7 to 9 inches or until urine flows and continue to advance at the bifurcation of the drainage bag and the balloon inflation port. What are you doing? You're catheterizing a male. If pain occurs when you're doing this, you're probably still in the urethra. Just advance it a little bit more with that and put the balloon up. You don't have to start over with this. Once again, it just, usually if there's some pain when you start to inflate the balloon, if you advance it, it's fine. Now, if you started to inflate the balloon before you advance it, what are you going to do? Deflate the balloon, advance it, put it in. That would just be common sense for you. Ventrogluteal, dorsogluteal, which is controversial, vastus lateralis and deltoid, what are these? They are intramuscular injection sites. You do have to know how to locate those. So, okay. Nutraceuticals, dietary and herbal supplements, probiotics, live microorganisms that are familiar or similar to those naturally found in the GI tract, aromatherapy. What type of products are these?
Alternative,
I'll take that. They're just natural products with this. Remember, the herbs are not classified as drugs. They're regulated less in the United States, where they're not regulated with our U.S. Food and Drug Administration with that. But can they still have interactions with drugs? Sure. Herbs have pharmacologic effects, even though we don't monitor them as much. So when anyone's going to start an herbal therapy, they need to talk it over with their healthcare practitioner so we can find out what the interaction is going to be with that. Holistic movement or holistic movement therapy, traditional Chinese martial art, has been adapted to be a mind-body exercise, great at combating stiff joints, and the goal is to integrate body movements, mind, concentration, muscle relaxation, and breathing to achieve the desired outcome. What are they practicing? They are having Tai Chi. 5 to 15 degree angle, double up, insert only 1/8 inch below the skin, typical dose is 0.01 to 0.1 milliliter. What type of injection? Intradermal, which would be a type of TB, but it's an intradermal. Most common type of arthritis, joint pain and loss of function characterized by progressive deterioration and loss of cartilage and bone in one or more joints, and osteophyte, crepitus, obesity is a common contributing factor. That is osteoarthritis with that. When you're dealing with osteoarthritis, pay particular attention to the ESR, which is the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, and that high sensitivity C-reactive protein. They're often elevated or slightly elevated with this condition. What are these? A yellow, aromatic, clear, gravities. Yeah, they're normal urines. Okay. And let me see if there's one. That's about it. Best exercise to help minimize osteoporosis? Walking. That's it. I hope it helps. That is a